Welcome everybody to the next talk. It's about L2 BSA, that's layer 2 bitstream access for broadband services. It's a complicated issue, more on the political side than on the technical one. Let's start with the personal issues. Hope that will work. Yep. So I have been grown up in East Germany. So the access to computer technology was not that easy. But I managed to have the Commodore 64, and during the unification change, I switched from the Commodore to Microsoft, to MS-DOS and Windows. But a few years later, 2 years later, I had to switch to Linux for a project in order to provide religious a website in Germany, one of the first about sects and about providing information about the dangers of religion. So we need a web server, and we found a possibility to do this with Linux, so I started with Linux. Next problem was to get access to the internet in these times, and I was part of the Interbuild Network e.V. in Germany. They are tried to build an internet for really ordinary people, and by ordinary people, the Union of Enthusiasts and Nerds. So they managed to bring the internet from the universities and from some companies to the masses and allow everybody to have access to the internet on a very simple and collegial base. So that was a grassroots activity I've been proud to be part of. And I see some of the people I have met in this time in this meeting here too. That's fine. Hi, everybody. Growing from this enthusiasm to a commercial activity started in 1996 when I co-founded an original ISP. And in this position, I was responsible for building the infrastructure of real commercial broadband ISPs in Thuringia. One was sold to another company, and the second one is still existing, and we are doing services for them. And one of the points we had in the second ISP lifetime was that we had to provide PPP. And we had a commercial appliance for this, and this commercial appliance was not sufficient anymore. And we thought about changing it to an open source solution, but none of the solutions were really applicable for our needs. It was too small or too unstable. And somebody told me that the Russian internet is running on NPD, on FreeBSD, on so-called NetGraph infrastructure. And I was very pleased to have contact to these people, and they told me they had no problems. So I switched the ISP to FreeBSD and NPD. The result was that we had kernel panics about every 2 days, and it took 3/4 a year to fix the bugs in the kernel and MPD software and so on. It was my start with FreeBSD. So, broadband in Germany. After, oh yeah, that's a horrible story. Let's start with the the early beginnings. Germany had an early start with networking, of course using the telephone network, so the copper lines, and of course they are using everything everybody else is doing. But in other areas of the world, for instance in Japan, they already noticed that copper is not the best way to do the last mile, and they insist on switching to fiber. Like many other countries are preparing in the 90s to do so. But in Germany, we had a problem. We had a government which was tightly coupled with factories who produce these copper infrastructure, and therefore they decided that they do not switch to fiber and still stick to the copper area. And it was so a massive shift in the decision making that it still persists to this day. In 1995, the same party, political party, chose to privatize the infrastructure and sold it out to a new founded company, the German Telekom or Deutsche Telekom. And in order to start such a company, they got all the infrastructure as a gift. And so they created politically a monopoly. Nobody else was able to have access to the households. And the consequence was that the competitors which want to start in this market was faced with an impossible mission, and they choose the way they choose the way to go to the curb. And the consequence was that the unbundling of the last mile was regulated, so that the Deutsche Telekom was forced to give access to the last mile, to the copper, into the households to competitors. And a few years later, after almost all in the world has changed to high-speed internet using fiber, the German internet was still very slow and expensive. So they tried to build faster internet access, and the technology was called vectoring. Vectoring is technology using all the signals from a bunch of copper cables and find out which cable has which signal, which signal influences which other line, and then compute which signal might come from which household. But this technology needs to have access to all the copper lines in an area at once, because we are doing signal processing on this. For the technical background, you may think of DSL as it's not using the copper line as a wire. It uses as a guide to a wireless signal. The wireless signal is guided by the wire on the surface, but it's not shielded in any case. So if the two copper lines are using the same cable, they spring from one cable to the other, And the vectoring technology is make use of this errors in transmission and recalculate which signal is coming from which household. So in the consequence, that means that we get a remonopolization of the last mile, and it took long time up to we get a regulated access to the last mile again. Now, without the layer one, only a layer two access, because layer one is vectoring. It has to be done by a single company in a single single device. So they had to find a solution to bring the layer two bitstream out to another ISP. The consequences of this whole mess with fiber is very simple. If you make a ranking how fast internet is available in which country, you will find Germany in this area here. It's fiber to the home or fiber to the building. And if you like, you might have a look at the other countries which are better or even worse than Germany. It's hard to be worse than Germany in digitalization. Currently, to this day, in Europe, only one company, only one country has a worse digitalization strategy than Germany, or deployment, digitalization deployment in Germany, it's Albania. Every other country in Europe do a better job than our country here. Okay. But to the solution. So we had a monopoly recreated by vectoring. As I said before, that we need to have the all the copper lines in one device. In order to make a breakout of these lines, we had to name the line to the household and say, we need all the bits on this line. Please bring it to a gateway in order to provide services to this household by another ISP. So we had a one-to-one mapping between the port and the gateway. And the technical solution is very simple. They only put a VLAN tag on the port and transport so a multiple tagged frame to the gateway, and there you have to process it. The consequence is obvious. At first, you have only 4,000 customers per gateway. You have only 4,000 VLAN tags you can use, so you can only number 4,000 ports. The second consequence is a little bit difficult. It's the consequence that you do not have the opportunity to have a smart network, distribution or aggregation network. For instance, you are not able to provide IPTV over such an layer 2 bitstream access, because you have to replicate all the traffic in the central unit. And so you have to send the same stream again and again to each customer, which is currently watching a special stream. Usually you would use multicast and make the replication as late as possible in the network. So you can't provide IPTV in this approach. That's an interesting point, because it means that the competition is not able to provide triple play. They are only able to provide double pay, play, so internet and voice, but not TV. Next problem is that if you have a DSL line, it's synchronized to a special speed, say for instance 200 megabits, but on the gateway line we have a gigabit or 10 gigabits, So we send much more traffic to the aggregation network or transport network than we can send out on the last mile. So we had a problem with packet loss. And the solution for this problem is very simple. It's strictly forbidden to send more data than can be sent to the customer. How do we know how much data we can send? That's by modifying the DHCP or PPP requests from the customer. They are adding a special option and saying the current synchronized speed is the following, so how much megabits up and down. So you have to provide the rules and traffic shaping. If you do not do this, if you send more traffic to the aggregation network of the other provider, then the DSL line is able to deal with, you have to pay a fine. The fine is about, it's a regulated price, it's about 2,000 euro per day and customer. So there's a strong motivation to implement shaping. No, there's no hardware flow control. Forget it. Even if the DSL line is shaping the synchronized speed, which is very common and maybe happen every minute, you will not get any notification about this because DHCP request or PPP resynchronization will not happen every time. If you build such a thing like we are doing, you have to calculate a little bit and say, okay, we have 1 million households in Thuringia. So we need 260 interconnection points. If we have 4,000 households per interconnection, but luckily we do not need this because we do not get all the households in the whole country here, of course. Only a very small percent. So we have only to have access to each region where a customer we want to serve is located. It's about 50 interconnections we need to take operate other than German Telecom operated areas. The rural areas are no problem because they are operated by us. So we only have to manage the connections to about six cities. We do not have any more cities in this area. Yeah, 100% market penetration would be very simple, but that's not the case here. So we have to use this approach. The main problem is that in order to terminate such an A10 NSP or L2 BSA, you have to buy an appliance. That's the same situation we started in 2008, where we switched to the FreeBSD. And we do not want to go this way again because these appliances are much, much more expensive. They are about €1 million per device. And they only support a single mode of connectivity, is PPPoE. I will later explain why they are doing so, and we choose to use DHCP and for IPv6 in multiple VLANs. But we run into problems which are designed to prevent DHCP and such services. But we have to deal with it. What happens on the wire? If you have a customer, the customer has a payload, appends a customer service tag, it's a CVLAN, saying that's traffic for internet or for voice or for management or something like this. And then you have the source and destination IP, the traffic, the packet or the frame is transported from this area. The destination MAC is coming first and the source port and the CVLAN and the payload, of course. On the DSLAM, where the last mile is terminated, the L2 BSA provider has to insert a second tag, an S tag, service provider tag. So all the traffic in between here, the payload and the CVLAN is completely opaque to the transporting service provider. That's a good thing. And now let's have a look on such a packet with real numbers. We have a packet in VLAN 140, which is internet in our case. And so it's the customer CPE, which is configured to our ISP and provides access to this network in this way. Now the customer is connected to a German telecom DSLAM. They are injecting the SVLAN 27 and hand over the packet to us. Very simple. And if we send back a packet in VLAN 27, it reaches the customer, and so we have a bidirectional one-to-one mapping. A few moments later, see this. The SVLAN has changed. They change on every DSL resync. They may change it even on other cases. We have noticed such changes. And the idea behind is that every new synchronization is a new session, which requires a new dynamic service provider VLAN. If we still assume that the old session is existing, we send to a drop hole. Our traffic will go out on the wrong SVLAN, and that's why it will be dropped, because there is no port associated to this SVLAN anymore. It will happen suddenly without any warning. If you are using PPP, there is almost no problem, because this situation will solve itself. PPP has to keep alive in the LCP frame. So if you lost the connection, it will notice and will start a complete resync. That's why you get a new information from the new PPP session, a new information about the DSL speed. And you can still connect the customer over the new PPP session. If you have DHCP, you have nothing. That's our situation. So at any time, the SVLAN might change. In many cases, even if it's in DSL resync, even the customer does not notice it, simply because in DSL modem, the real router is behind the DSL modem, they are decoupled, and the DSL modem will make a resync, but will not notify the router of the customer that they had changed the synchronization, because the whole equipment depends on the idea that the DSL line is well defined and well recognized, and this is completely changed by choosing a random number at any time. So what we do is to simplify the approach by make it more complex, as usual in technology. So we have from the customer side, we have the CVLAN, then the transport provider will add an SVLAN. We want to have it cheap, so we do not use a single server per interconnection. We use a server with multiple interfaces. At the moment, we have about 15 to 20 interfaces per server. We do not need to be very high speeds. We do not have so much customers per interconnection. In order to aggregate this, we have added an AVLAN, an aggregate VLAN, so we can name the interface. That allows us to make the cross configuration per interface. Then the magic happens. The magic is to rotate the VLANs. So if we have the VLANs in another other order, we can start with the C VLAN, which was the inner one at first, and can build a NetGraph network for a service. So we have a different cross configuration for each service in a static way. Then we can decouple the interface, and then as the last step, we can decouple the line. So the dynamic one is in the on the end, and that's easier to handle. Let's have a look. That was the approach. Traffic is coming from an interface from the L2 BSA provider. We have some patching, a patch node, and for the course. The diamond nodes are VLAN nodes. Here we have a traffic shaper. So for each line, we have a traffic shaper. We are not allowed to send more traffic to the line than the DSL is in sync. So we have to aggregate over all the VLANs, all the services we have, and we have to provide a shaping over all these things in one step. That's why we are doing this on the interface level. And then that's the aggregation here. We have more than one line. This is the rotation step. Then we break out the customer VLANs. We have, for instance, a cross session for IPTV, if we could use it, or for voice. Or we have the simple session for internet. Then we have to break out the aggregation line, then the SVLAN from the provider. And then we can go to a bridge, and the bridge is a VLAN on our network, and we can go to the whole platform, IP platform we already have, so we do not need to develop anything new here. What are the problems? Blue and red are existing nodes. That's an NGE node, and that's in order to bring out to inspect it for DHCP in order to set up the traffic without any problem. The green nodes, the bridge nodes, they do their work, but only in the lab. Orange are the user space programs and DHCP breakout, looking on the DHCP options, setting up the appropriate parameters traffic shaping. On the other hand, we do not know which line is coming, which SVLAN is. We have a nomad running here, so PostScript again, which is setting up a new VLAN as to the bridge. So we can use the bridge for differentiating the lines by MAC addresses. Each end device should have a different MAC address, so we can use the bridge and say, oh, that's line so-and-so, and then it's SVLAN so-and-so on. Let's have a look a little bit later. In order to bring this up, we had some modifications, had to do some modifications of FreeBSD. First, are simple bugs that frames didn't pass through the chip, or that the magical node has to be come into the kernel itself for the VLAN rotation. Then the problems with the bridge node, which was very hard because they are the NG bridge node has an arbitrary limit of 16 links to connect to. It's a little bit low for our purposes, so we have to bring it up to unlimited links. Then the next problem is that this create so large netgraph messages that they're not able to bring it in user space. And then, in order to stop this from growing arbitrarily large, we make the bridge node to stop learning from the uplink ports that the MAC addresses are not flooding the table of the bridge node. It's the only node in the graph world which is not production ready because it's not multi-threaded. All the activities through this node is on a single core. So the whole device, the whole server was limited to about 800 megabit to 1 gigabit, one core processing for all the nodes, all the lines. For Quoz, there are some modifications necessary because we need coloring the traffic and add the shaper to honor this so that the green traffic, which is usually voice traffic, is in shaping. And additional changes to make the source, the graph a little bit more compact. Our problems we had was the same VLAN in different VLANs, same MAC in different VLANs. It's possible that a customer device is operating on multiple VLANs, for instance, untagged and tagged at the same time with the same MAC address, and we have to deal with it. We have overlapping MAC addresses from different devices because several CPEs, so customer boxes, increase the MAC address by one for each VLAN. If you have a lot of VLANs, you have a good chance to reach the MAC space of the next device, especially if you buy devices on a pallet with increasing serial numbers. Then the chances are very high that you have a lot of these devices in the situation. Then we had a problem that the customer are free to use a router on their own decision. And so they do not have to use a prepared router from us. And of course, they have in many cases very interesting and differences. Have to be worked, and they still have to work, and then you are on the way to end, first send the device to the customer which is working, or have a long discussion with the customer and saying what he is doing wrong, or if you are going to the network guy and say make it happen so that the customer is lucky. That's the common approach. We have a problem with the customer, find a solution so that the customer is going is come up online and do no longer complain about the service. Then we have problems with German Telekom. German Telekom sometimes is able to say, we have a DSL sync with 0 megabits per second. 0 megabits per second means that we, due to the penalty fee, we do not have to send out any data. That means that the DHCP response will not go out. The device will not get an IP address at all because it's not allowed to send it out. And of course, a lot of broken interfaces, especially if you have untagged, then you are violating IEEE, and so on and so forth. Real world example. That's the net graph of a running system at the moment. One with not so much lines. It's a new device here. On top, we have the aggregator VLAN, which adds from multiple lines incoming the A VLAN. Then we have the rotation ASC to CAS. Now we have the C, so the service VLAN at the first place, and we can go out with VLAN 140 or anything else. So for 140, we go out, make a DHCP sniffer with BPF node, and then to a socket, which is not shown here. Then we go out, make the aggregation line. So we have two lines here. And for these, we have the dynamic links to the bridge so that every line has the SVLAN, the ALAN, the CVLAN, and so on. And that's the untagged case. We do not have enough VLANs in the to rotate, then we have to process as an incomplete one. There is nothing to do, so it can be, it's nothing special. But you see that you have a problem, the untagged and the tagged are going to one bridge. There are others which are going to be the same bridge too. That's the Netgraph node for the services. We are seeing that for the internet traffic, we only make a copy for the DHCP and for this voice traffic, we have a cost in order to make the right tags. We have color mark tag coming in, and we need to go out and say which priority class it has to be in order to fulfill the specification of the interconnection. Let's go a little bit more down and see the lower part to our infrastructure. That's our infrastructure here, where we our complete so we high-speed internet bridge, and for the voice connect, each line a traffic shaper, no, classifying traffic to be sent out with priority and with sent out without priority. The reason behind is that there is penalty fee for sending out too much we have to limit this, and this, of course, we have to do it per stream. On the other hand, in the upper case, up to the interface to the German Telecom or the L2 BSA line, we have to make the shaping for the whole traffic. So we split out the VLANs for for each of the customers, and there we have currently you see the speeds here. I've named the nodes in a way that they reflect the speeds. So the name of the node is really shape 116/46, so that the Netgraph output is automatically providing the information which is hidden in the car node. All other traffic which is not yet classified goes out without any shaping. Then we have the patching, so we have a classification saying, for instance, that's priority 4 traffic. Then we go in and patch the bits for the VLAN tag, so that we have the right information on the line, and that's going out to the German Telecom, and they are providing it to the correct customer. So, in practice, that's from yesterday. We have several MACs and several bridges, the internet or the voice bridge, and we have random chosen link names, which is available on A VLANs or aggregation VLANs naming the line. We have the S VLAN and we have the C VLAN, and that's a typical output from our monitoring system. Can be very long. That's why the problem with the netcraft messages binary to ASCII conversion. Okay. So yeah, that's the you see a lot of different VLANs we are using here. 180 is for business customers. They are choosing to use their own devices. They have to be handled a little bit different, but okay. If you have such a situation here with Antec, that's fine. But if you have a situation like here with an tagged one, most CPEs sending out frames on the Antec VLAN, despite it's not configured. For instance, they are sending out traffic for OAM, so Ethernet message traffic, about 5 to 20 per second, and they are coming with the same MAC address here and confusing the system. This unwanted traffic is filtered out directly on the link node. So traffic coming in from the outside is first filtered for any unwanted traffic with the BPF node. It works out of the box. There is nothing special here. Okay, yeah, now it's up to you. We have 2 minutes. Yes, the output of the graph is SVG. We are using SVG on our monitoring system because you can tag them or you can make a label on the link so you can hover over the graph and get more information. TR69 do usually happen on an unconfigured device on the Antec VLAN. On all other cases, it depends. We have devices which are configured to choose 3 different VLANs before they are choosing the Antec VLAN. We have notes here. It's fine. Why do we stick to FreeBSD despite a harsh welcome? Because I do not have any other option. Very simple. We had thrown away the other systems and we are very sure that we can manage the problem within weeks, but it takes months. It was an unpleasant time. The main solution for the old situation was that we had a lot of problems with memory leak, so I tweaked FreeBSD 8. I tweaked the memory management that free memory buffers are not freed but going into a cycle into a small cyclic buffer. So they are delayed, freed, and this solves almost all of the problems we had. So there are possibilities which you again do if you have the source code. Network topology lock is not a problem at the moment because we do not change topology that often. So, it's already answered. Of course, it did not. By the tunneling of. Yeah, I try to make an answer. If German Telekom is going to an other provider and asking for stream, you might come up with the situation that you're saying, okay, we are using the regulated providing you the exactly the same interconnection point as you are providing to us, and the answer from German Telekom is no. You never do this. We can't handle this. You have to provide us a fixed SVLAN for each customer, and we name you the S per customer. If we have such a situation in the other way, we didn't need this whole mess here. We could do it with a simple Cisco router. Because if everything is stable, you can map VLANs and tech VLANs to the service instances, and you are fine with it. We consider this approach, but the dynamics make it a mess. The other point, because the question about why it's not layer three, because layer three overlays were not state of the art at the time where this standardization process started. The Broadband Forum, which is mainly responsible for this, between 1997 to 2002, in this time, they had the first drafts out. So we are still using a technology from 20 years ago. And that's an issue with standardization. If you have a standardization process, it always will choose the technology 20 years ago. Sorry if I do. If you lost me, I'm sorry. I will drop the video. It might be better. So, it's simply the problem of the time of standardization. We have a standardization here 20 years ago, and this time layer three overlay was not state of the art. Multi-threaded bridge. Why? Simply because I didn't look. No, because FreeBSD 13 started later than I started with this issue. But it's really an interesting point to match up the code between both bridging interfaces. I think it's not necessary to have two incomplete code bases which overlap major overlapping functionality in the code. Each of the implementations are incomplete in other areas because they have different purposes. So, No, we do not use a layer to bitstream access for ourselves, but we use a layer to bitstream access for other providers like Deutsche Telekom. How many bits per second can a FreeBSD box handle? We are using FreeBSD for carrier grade NAT2, and we are able to handle without special tweaking. We are able to handle about 12 gigabits per second in NAT. The problem you have is that you have to distribute it over the cores, so you have to inspect your server very carefully. You have to have a look where each interface card is connected to which PCI bus. You have to make sure that which PCI bus is connected to which CPU. In some cases, you have to provide additional CPUs in order to get a direct link for each PCI Express lane to the CPU and to the you have to have a look. But in the normal situation where you have an processor with about 16 cores, it's enough for this task. Yeah, can get a gigabit per second carrier grade NAT. I don't know if we have an if we have an lab at the moment for the L2 BSA connection, but because we are taking only gigabit lines from the interconnection, simply because there are no more customers on the line, and so it's sufficient enough. I think the peak we have with 16 lines is about 8. I think that was the peak here.